It's here.
So, are you... Yes, for Bernie. Are you aware that utilitarianism has a very long history in the West? Jeremy Bentham, John Stuart Mill, that the West, philosophers in the West have been wrestling with a calculus for hundreds of years, and generally they've failed. You know, I'll give you a couple of quick examples. The French Revolution, I mean, to you, that would be heaven. The goddess reason is worshipped. We're going to have a rational society, and the result is slaughter. Because the question is far, far broader than just having a calculus.
No, that wouldn't be heaven for me, just to interrupt you for
a little
bit.
Go ahead, go ahead.
Well, like I said, there's three principles I would use. I mean, human flourishing does not mean going around killing people you disagree with, like
to
in the French Revolution.
To you, that's the problem, is you keep on assuming your vision is the only possible definition. There are communist versions of flourishing. There are Nazi versions of flourishing. There are extreme environmentalist versions of flourishing. There are any number of versions.
Right.
And just to have a calculus, and by the way, look at Jeremy Bentham's calculus, and it's a lot more, there are a lot more points than just those three. But I
also said two other things too, like reciprocity and
okay.
individual free rights. And so, for example, with the communists, if they're going to go around killing people, that's a very gross violation on free rights.
But you're essentially taking what guys like you have tried to take this issue, come up with a couple of points, and the result has been slaughter of millions, because the issue is far too complex. Because it comes down to how you define the flourishing. And you may not like the Nazi definition, but you have to give a case, or the communists or the extreme environmentalists, but you have to give a case for why.
I give you why, because it violates individual rights.
What's frustrating about reading people like Dawkins and Harrison is you make assumptions, and then you just self-evidently assume that your assumption is unassailable. That why should somebody that does not accept individual rights or equality, why is that less of a position than somebody that does?
The reason why I use individual rights is because some moral issues require that. Like you said, if you didn't have that, that would be a glaring hole where abuses could come in. And so that's one of those
It depends on your goal. I mean, maybe, but anyway, one more question.
Well, the goal is a peaceful society, a flourishing.
To you. What if I'm an extreme environmentalist and I think that we need to go down to 100 million people?
Mm-hmm.
You may not agree with that, but I have not heard any articulation other than some vague sort of, well, it's not flourishing, which is basically a safe box for you to hide behind. You've obfuscated this entire issue by not defining your terms, because if you were forced to define what flourishing is, you would have to set up standards and we could go after them and destroy them. And so you've created this safe little space that nobody can get at you.
Well, you're making it sound like flourishing is a difficult word to understand.
It's a meaningless word because it's so vague. You're using it in a way that's vague enough so that it can mean anything. It's a meaningless discussion.
Well, here's the thing, though. This is what Sam Harris says. Once people agree that it's about flourishing, that is a huge, huge... major development in morality, because the Christians, for example, they're not even in that game. They're into like divine command theory. It's like, why is this good or bad? Well, because God said it.
I'm a Christian and I'm also a utilitarianist. So I mean, you made straw men all night. You made little your soteriology was nothing but a big straw man. But so we do agree. Republicans and Democrats agree we should flourish. So great, Bernie, we all agree. The country is united. But they all have definitions of what that flourishing means, so it's meaningless.
Okay, what's an example, though? Give an example. What's the difference?
The whole gay marriage issue.
Okay, right. And that's a good discussion if it's about flourishing. That's
but
good.
But they don't agree
but here's
they have
the problem.
Standards.
I know, but here's the problem. Some people, they don't bring in flourishing and what's good for society. They just say, I'm against it because it's icky. Or I'm against it because God said so. There's no brain thought processes behind it. That's the problem. If it's about flourishing, that's a good discussion. Does homosexual marriage hurt society? Good discussion. Let's talk about it.
You never question your own assumptions, and I think that's what's frustrating. Everything you think is just obviously self-evidently true. You just said a whole myriad of things that philosophers have spent millennia fighting over. I mean, I think for a lot of these guys, if you just take like a philosophy 101, like a survey course, I think it would help a lot of people like Dawkins and Richard Harris. But the other point, and one of the points we're leaving out
is altruism.
Altruism. That ultimately, when 9/11 happened, some firemen went up to rescue people. They knew they were dead. Mm-hmm. They got the last rites going up there. Mm-hmm. That the naturalist worldview cannot account for altruism. It cannot account for saving Jews from the Nazis and putting your own life in
jeopardy. Actually, I think it can.
And utilitarianism has nothing to do with
that. Maybe not, but I mean, our biological system is the way we evolved. I mean, it's like, you know, I don't really want to throw my life away, but if my parents or if my kids or my wife was in danger, I would put myself in harm's way.
We're not talking about your kids and life.
It's the same thing. It's a tribal thing.
We're not talking about that. We're talking about altruism, which means you give up your life for no possible gain.
It's for your tribe, basically.
No, you're doing a straw man. When the people went up in 9/11, the firemen, they did not. Their wives and children were not up in the tower.
It's America, though. I know. America is their tribe.
No. The Jews, the Poles that saved Jews from the Nazis that were putting their lives at risk, they had no, it's not their tribe, it's not their family. That is the heart of religion. That altruistic sacrifice, that's ultimately what Christian morality is about. And that is something that no naturalist I've ever seen make any sort of account or even attempt to, because it's a joke. Your worldview is not broad enough to include altruism.
Well, I'll tell you, there's the opposite thing, though, too, where people can rush off the war when they believe in God, because it's like, I'm going to give my life for God and country. Hey, if I die, no big deal. I'm going to heaven. And that's an extreme problem on the other side.
Well, you didn't address what I just said. You just came up with
neurosis. Yeah, I've never heard that objection before about altruism before. I mean, I've seen before where, like I said, in biology it explains a lot. The 9/11 one, I haven't heard that argument before. I can think about it, but
people use our game theory. That's one, and I've studied game theory. Game theory does not explain altruism. The other one I've heard is Dawkins' selfish gene, which is ridiculous. That genes have any sort of a mind or... Anyway, that's a whole other... There are a lot of things for you to consider. You're only just looking at the very surface here on all this stuff.
Okay. Well, I guess we can agree to disagree on that. So the person in the back has been waiting for a while.